Thatcher Demko. Happy birthday, dude. I can't even begin to comprehend what we had just witnessed, but the Vancouver Canucks have won two games in a row, Bruce Boudreau is 2-0 on this team, and we didn't even have the Bruce There It Is chance going on in the arena. Vancouver plays the Boston Bruins in Rogers Arena here tonight, and it is a 2-1 shootout victory on Thatcher Demko's birthday. Now, even though it's easy to go out there and say, okay, Demko did the thing, he made the saves, good on him, there were so many other notable performances in this game that even though this game was really fishy at times, a few bad penalties here and there, a few bad turnovers, a few really bad giveaways, even though Thatcher Demko was greeted with a post off of Oscar Steen, another deflection that goes clearly off the crossbar, a disallowed goal for offside, the Vancouver Canucks still went out there and played a game that was so reminiscent of the new changes that there are just a number of things to talk about. Firstly, the defense. We had ourselves no OEL in this game. Kyle Burrow stepped in instead. We also had ourselves Travis Hamonic, who, upon drawing a Brad Marchand interference penalty, actually was injured for the rest of the game and sat out at the halfway mark. The defense in this game, Tyler Myers especially, they came to play, and my goodness, was I super impressed by some of the moves and the breakouts that this team was able to accomplish. I have never been so proud of Tucker Poolman, Travis Hamonic, and Luke Shen for their abilities to flip the puck high out into the neutral zone. And it's funny because this play, it actually freaking works too. Like, we haven't seen this at all under the Travis Green system. Dump and chase out of your own zone? No way. It's only dump and chase into the offensive zone. You always gotta try to break the puck out by using flat passes over to the opposing blue line from inside your own blue line. That's how Travis Green system goes out there and works. But no. This team takes the breakouts very slowly. They all collect themselves in their own zone, and they all skate out to the neutral zone. The flip pass comes from one of the D-men, and it lands usually on the stick of one of these Canucks guys streaking in with speed, catching a flat-footed Boston Bruins team off guard. This is a really interesting strategy, and it worked really well in this game. Now, aside from that, the forwards, dude, these guys, you could see it. There's a really big change in body language. The way these guys are going out there and forechecking, it's completely different than it had been a week ago. And just seeing this team perform against what I would say is a pretty good team in Boston. Sure, Boston might be a one-line team. Sure, Smith and Hall are really not playing all too well, but Charlie Coyle is their center. This team was still a pretty good test for just trying to evaluate where the Vancouver Canucks are, despite the fact that, yes, the Vancouver Canucks are on paper a lot worse this season than Boston is. And don't get me wrong, even though Vancouver won this game, the deserve to win-o-meter on MoneyPuck says that Boston had a 75% chance of winning this game based off of the high danger chances alone, and I wouldn't go out there and doubt that. Thatcher Demko had to face some pretty high-quality shots. As we noted, some of them went off the post, others went off the crossbar, others were just swatted at and barely missed by guys like Brad Marchand, and others were just completely disallowed goals on breakaways because Erik Haula went a little bit too far over the blue line. But this game was a game where the Vancouver Canucks were just going out there and putting in work. So many odd man rushes and speedy off the rush chances where you had yourself some really good looks, and I say just looks and not shots and not opportunities, because the Vancouver Canucks on so many of these chances, they flubbed the pass, or they shot it wide, or they shot it too high, or they hit the post, or whatever. This team was definitely not flawless in this game. Don't get me wrong. There were so many opportunities that I think, had the Canucks been just a little bit more fine-tuned, they could have gotten a few more goals in this one because they were just so close to catalyzing those chances. But for example, in the second period halfway through, Nils Höglander is the guy who leads the rush. It's a 2-on-1, and instead of making the shot where he has an angle, he stops, tries to get the pass through the legs of the Boston defender, and it doesn't work. It gets completely swatted away. Boston dumps it out to Erik Haula. That's how he gets the breakaway, and he scores on Demko. However, it was disallowed. Thank you, birthday gods, coming in here, giving Thatcher Demko a solid. We also had ourselves a few really good opportunities shorthanded. There was that power play that the Boston Bruins had in, I believe it was the second period as well. I think it was the Tyler Myers penalty, where the Vancouver Canucks outchanced the Bruins while the Canucks were shorthanded. There were like three odd man rushes going back the other way. And, you know, as I said, baby steps, right? A few videos ago, baby steps. You're building upwards from here because you were at rock bottom a few days ago. Baby steps, because even though you got those odd man rushes, you had the 2-on-0s and the 1-on-1s, etc., the Vancouver Canucks still went out there and flubbed these shorthanded opportunities. They almost had a few shorthanded goals, but the passes were either a little bit too far away or the shots were a little bit too high. There's some fine-tuning that needs to be done here, but just seeing them force those opportunities in the first place was a very, very positive sign. The first goal of the game, though, comes off of that play we talked about earlier. Travis Hamonic gets injured off of Brad Marchand's interference call. The Vancouver Canucks in the ensuing power play get a very, very much needed break for one Brock Boeser as Hughes goes over to the right side. Miller holds onto the puck. He does not slap pass it, but instead he takes it, holds it, controls it, then he shoots it towards the net, and Brock Boeser is right there to tip it in. 1-0 Vancouver. Brock's got goals in back-to-back games. This one wasn't a fluke anymore. It's a legit tip-in goal. You look at the guy's face, he's smiling ear to ear. You could tell he wanted that goal more than anybody. Dude, Brock Besser's got goals in back-to-back games. How does that feel? We'll talk a little bit more about JT Miller as the night goes on, but he gets himself the primary assist, and Hughes, of course, getting the secondary here, so good on them for getting on the board as well. But the game takes a little bit of a turn in the third period, because as we know, last week or whenever the last time these two teams played was, I forgot, I think it was last week, a week and a half ago, last time they played, the Vancouver Canucks had the lead after 40 minutes, but they lost this one because in the third they gave up power play goals against. They hadn't had a penalty in that game up to that point, and in the third period, that's when Boston was like, okay, we're going to start doing this now, we're going to start scoring. Same thing kind of was looming in the aura of Rogers Arena in this one, as the Vancouver Canucks end up going shorthanded off of a slashing play by Juho Lamikko. This one wasn't really a good one, but it's one where you're like, okay, they killed off some earlier penalties, they were really good shorthanded earlier in the game, let's see what happens now. And the Vancouver Canucks, to their credit, they force things back into the Boston zone. But guess what happens after Jeremy Swayman comes out to touch the puck? He gets tripped out in front by one JT Miller, who is looking off to his own bench, trying to reverse. JT Miller gets the worst penalty called this season. It's a goalie interference penalty while you're already down by one. It's 5-on-3 now. Boston goes out there and cycles it. It's a shot from the blue line. Bergeron is right there to tip it in by Thatcher Demko. Luke Shen is committing to both. I believe it was Charlie Coyle on his right and Patrice Bergeron on his left, but because he has to commit to one, it leaves the other guy open. Bergeron is right there. He tips it in. Okay, it's 1-1. The rest of the game sees no more goals, but we do see a lot more chances as the Vancouver Canucks go out there, still with that aggression and still with that forechecking. The Boston Bruins, on the other hand, really start to put the pressure on. You can see some chances from Marchand. You can see Patrice Bergeron going out there too. You can see Pasternak roaming around the zone. And Vancouver, much to their credit, they get some really good opportunities. Cross-crease chances stopped by Jeremy Swayman, who was absolutely magnificent in this game here today. Rookie goaltender, I don't care. This guy is a legend already in my books. The guy was absolutely fantastic. But Thatcher Demko also stood tall too, despite being beaten a few times and getting lucky. In the overtime, it was a little bit more exciting too. We had ourselves what was a great period to watch. It was kind of intense, you know, kind of antsy, seeing a lot of the plays being made. Tyler Myers at this point is playing like half the entire game. Like, it's kind of crazy because since Hamonic had been taken out, it's now just Myers over there taking the load. But there was one moment in particular in overtime that was really, oh boy, it was a bad one for Miller. It's Tyler Myers in his own zone. It's after a really long shift after the Bruins were cycling it around, and Tyler Myers sees JT Miller streaking up into the neutral zone. Myers does the long flip out that they had been doing earlier on in the game, and Miller, instead of going over to the puck, goes towards the bench, leading to an icing call. This was the worst timed play that you could have imagined, and JT Miller was the guy who kind of messed it up here too. This one ended up in Boston playing their power line. It was McAvoy, Marchand, and Bergeron against a tired unit of Dickinson, Miller, and Myers. Thankfully, the Vancouver Canucks were able to go out there and get things done. diffuse the pressure and change up properly, but unfortunately for both teams, we don't see any goals in the extra 5 minutes. But then the shootout happens, and this is where things get interesting, because starting things off, Elias Pettersson for the Vancouver Canucks, we all kind of knew that Petey, he's got this confidence thing going on right now. The guy didn't get a point in this game. Obviously, there was only one goal, and he wasn't even on the power play when the goal was scored, but Pettersson has a chance to go out there and really make a statement with this shootout. Unfortunately, he bobbles it in the slot and he loses it, man. Oh, Elias Pettersson, his streak of misfortune continues here. And now Boston has a chance to go out there and actually make things work. It's David Pastrnak against Thatcher Demko. Pastrnak has been not himself this season, shooting at a career low percentage of 8.8% or whatever it is. He comes in, you see him slowly. Oh no, what's he gonna do? And then he shoots it wide. What in the world is going on with these superstars whose last names start with P? Pastrnak, Pettersson? Just complete duds on the shootout right there. Then you get yourselves Vancouver coming back out here. It's JT Miller, shootout specialist as he is. He comes in on the left side, serpentines into the middle, backhand, forehand, and he gets it done. Jeremy Swayman goes down. Miller with a little pitter-patter jump over the guy at the end there to really add insult to injury. It's 1-0 Vancouver in the shootout, and then the Bruins do something that I'm kind of surprised they did. I was saying the entire time, you know, Marchand. It's going to be Marchand next up, or McAvoy if they really want to try it. But it's Charlie Coyle. Huh. Okay, Charlie Coyle goes out there on the shootout. What is he going to do? Oh my goodness, he just got easily stopped by Demko. A very quick, simple blocker, stick-side save, and all of a sudden the Vancouver Canucks have a chance to win the shootout if Captain Bo Horvat can come in here and get one. Lo and behold, Bo Horvat skates in, slows down. He holds and he holds and he holds. He sees Jeremy Swayman's left knee drop down and go up a little bit. And so Horvat knows that Swayman is focusing on the five hole. And so what does he do? He rips it top shelf and Swayman isn't expecting it. Swayman barely even moves his blocker hand as the puck goes right by. Vancouver wins this shootout 2-0 and Bruce Boudreau's record on the season under Vancouver, it's also 2-0. Dude, we're 7 points out of a playoff spot now? Okay, I don't want to say that. Okay. Calm down, Lego. Talk to me in the comments. What do you think about the Vancouver Canucks improving to 4-1-0 in their last five games, 2-0-0 under Bruce Boudreau? What do you think about this game? Boston fans, let me know your thoughts in the comments as well. I hope you enjoyed this special Rolls 99. And bye.